Today on Matters of Fact, the relationship between the Philippines and the European Union seems to be facing some serious challenges amid President Duterte's tirades against the regional bloc. This, of course, was the president's response to criticisms over the human rights situation in the Philippines. But what exactly is the situation on the ground? We'll talk about that with the former senator and now the country's new special envoy to the European Union, who now joins us from our Rockwell studio, former Senate President Edgardo Angara. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Christian.
Senator, not a few people were quite pleasantly surprised that you were appointed to the Duterte administration as the special envoy. First, let's talk about your job description. What exactly are you expected to do as the special envoy to EU?
The job is really a problem-solving job. It's not a fixed position that you'll be posted, but it's a I go to the EU if there is a special concern that we want to resolve and discuss with our EU partners. So this is a parang troubleshooting job lang. Mm-hmm.
And especially
but it's
since
a very important job.
Yeah, and especially since I understand we still do not have a replacement to the former Philippine ambassador to the EU.
That's correct. We have no regular ambassador in Brussels.
Mm-hmm. Now,
so sir, I think it's more important that we try to confront and discuss with our EU partners these problems.
And there were reports that you only be staying on the job for a few months. Is that correct, sir? And why is
that's
that?
Correct.
Why
that's
is that?
Correct. Well, because this is a limited scope, limited role. It's not a permanent role, regular part of the bureaucracy. It's a troubleshooting job for the president and for our country.
Now, what is the main concern? Basically, what did the president tell you when it comes to troubleshooting a particular problem with the EU? Are we talking here for example, the Philippines' inclusion in the GSP Plus, which some people say might have been compromised because of the president's verbal attacks against the EU?
Well, I think there are basically, as I see it, three core problems that may be dividing the EU and the Philippines. The first one, of course, is this human rights issue, the so-called extrajudicial killings. The second is the reimposition of the death penalty. And the third, while it's not being spoken out publicly, is the reduction of the age of liability from 16 to 12. Mm. Now, let me take first the first one, human rights. In the case of the human rights violation that the country is engaged in extrajudicial killings in the drug war, I think that issue is already with the International Criminal Court. So in a way, as we lawyers say, it's pending in court, so let's not comment on it. Let's leave it to the International Criminal Court so that there'll be a third-party, independent, objective assessment whether the country is in fact, whether President Duterte is in fact committing violation of human rights. The second, the reimposition of death penalty. This is, to me, the more serious issue because I was the one, when I was still in the Senate, who introduced the removal of the death sentence in our penal criminal system.
Yeah.
And this is a very strong sentiment in Europe. As you know, Europe got together a treaty on human rights eliminating death penalty across the continent, and it caught on universally. So this is part of an international agreement we acceded and signed up with that I think would be a red line as far as EU is concerned. Mm. And the third one is the reduction of the age of liability from 16 to 12. As it is now, the 16-year-olds are being used by crime syndicates, by drug syndicates to commit crimes because they can do it with impunity because they have no liability. But worse, if you reduce it to 12-year-old, even my grandchildren will be vulnerable. Mm. Our grandchildren will be vulnerable.
Now,
so I think we've got to carefully examine all these proposals, these two, death penalty and lowering of criminal liability, before Congress passes it and before the President gets to consider whether to approve or veto.
But have you explained this to the President himself and also to the European Union?
I have explained this to the European delegation. About 2 weeks ago, the head of the Southeast Asia and East Asia division of the EU came to see me together with the resident EU ambassador and their staff, and we discussed this very openly, very candidly, and I have the impression that they're quite eager, well, not eager, but they're really open to maintaining a good relations with the Philippines and with the ASEAN in general. Mm. As you know, Christian, the EU is becoming our number one trading partner, our export market, number one export market. And there's a great number of educated professionals within the EU. So because of that common set of values, I think they also see the value of keeping our friendship and cooperation together.
But as far as the President is concerned, do you think the feeling is mutual? Because the President has said a lot of perhaps nasty criticism against the European bloc after it criticizes war on drugs.
Yes, I appreciate that, Christian, but you know, that's the President's manner of speaking. He speaks out his mind, whatever occurs to his mind. But you can see that once you explain the situation and he's briefed thoroughly on all aspects of the issue, he changes his mind.
Okay.
He even will withdraw his objectionable remarks. We saw that in the rejection of the EU aid after it was explained, I understand, by Secretary Dominguez and by other cabinet members. I think the President understood that there are really no strings attached to the EU aid, because that's a grant.
Yeah.
And that's a grant for peacemaking in Mindanao.
Yeah, in his own region.
In his own region. And the flames now are over Mindanao.
Yeah. But given the predispositions of the President, his inclination to say out loud what he thinks in a particular point in time, does this make your job as special envoy somehow difficult, given what has already happened in the past?
Well, the task itself is difficult, and it's not going to be made easy by public newspaper media exchange of words. So I'm sure the President understands that, because he wants to succeed. He wants to be a successful president who is more a peacemaker rather than a troublemaker.
Now, sir, let's talk about our continuing inclusion in the GSP Plus. I understand there was an announcement from the from the EU ambassador to the Philippines earlier this year that they would send a delegation to the Philippines to review our participation, our perks under the GSP Plus. What is the situation now?
You know, that's a regular feature of the GSP Plus. GSP Plus means duty-free entry of our products into the European Union, and that's a huge market, very lucrative for the Philippines. And the more appealing aspect of the GSP Plus is that we are now allowed to export to the EU fisheries, marine, and agricultural products, which therefore helps our countryside more than the urban areas, and that's why we want to protect that and conserve it. Now, there is this regular monitoring of compliance, because as many tariff regime requires, even the WTO, or a free trade agreement with the U.S. as such, there are conditions that they impose for the continuance of the preferential trade, such as, you know, you don't abuse your fishermen or your workers in a canning factory.
Labor rights, basically.
Right, labor standards, and of course some human rights standard. So, and I think that's quite reasonable in a Christian country like the Philippines. We understand that very well, and in a Christian region like Europe, I think they also understand that. And I think so far, knock on wood, we've been getting a good rating, a favorable rating on this monitoring system.
So we're not
We must continue.
Yeah.
We must continue that.
How likely will the Philippines lose its perks or privileges under the GSP Plus, given what is happening now here in the country, the criticism when it comes to the human rights situation here?
I think of the three issues I cited at the beginning, I think the most damaging to us is the reimposition of the death penalty. To me, that's a red line to them, and we'll automatically lose our trade preferences with Europe, and that's going to be damaging to coastal and countryside development, especially in Mindanao.
Have you explained this to the president, sir, the repercussions of, let's say, if we actually pass or reinstate the death penalty? Of course, the possibilities that we would lose our privileges under GSP Plus.
Not yet, Christian, but I have a pending request to see the president before I leave for Europe in July. And I really intend to explain to him. And I'm sure, you know, the president is a pretty intelligent person. He's trained in reason and pragmatism. He will understand, I think, the consequences of us losing GSP Plus.
But you're a veteran politician. You've seen everything practically. Now, do you think, let's say, the president actually decides to somehow soften on his position regarding death penalty? What about the House of Representatives, for example? The House Speaker himself has been very, very supportive of this move by the president, and the supermajority has come up with its own arguments in favor of reinstating the death penalty, and then all of a sudden, you can just stop talking about it? Can you do it as simple as that?
No, it's not as simple as that. But I think in the case of our speaker and the House, I think they pretty follow the inclination and the instruction of the president, because they're really the main support, the main political support of the president. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure that if the president requests them not to, well, they already passed it. It's going to be pending in the Senate. Then his allies, his political allies, will follow suit. Will follow his wishes.
Now, sir, let's talk about the situation in Mindanao. The president, of course, has declared martial law for the entire region to address what he calls a rebellion endangering public safety and security in the entire Mindanao region. Now, special envoy to the European Union, is this actually an issue as far as the EU is concerned? The fact that you have a martial law imposed in Mindanao, which is, of course, a major development subject for the EU.
I'm not as much concerned over the declaration of martial law in Mindanao as the other issues I cited. Number one, because the whole world, through media, through both the traditional and social, the whole world are seeing the atrocities and violence being committed against our people in Marawi. And the other day, you interviewed an expert on terrorism from Australia or from the EU.
Sydney
and
Jones,
and
yeah.
They said that the from the region, and she said that the threat of ISIS to the Philippines is real. It may be subtle, it may be unseen, it may be unpublicized, but it's real. because it seems that ISIS has now targeted at least the ASEAN and the Philippines in particular as going to be the hub of that extremism and terrorism.
So do you think? Okay, sir, go ahead.
Yeah. So I think that we owe it to our public to know more about what is ISIS, what is Muslim extremism, so that we can take precaution. They can take precaution, and our armed forces and the intelligence community can be on their guard from now on. That's the only thing.
So do you think, sir, it won't be that difficult for the Philippine government, or in your case, a special envoy to the EU, to somehow explain or even justify perhaps the measures being implemented by the government, by the president, given the situation, the ISIS threat now in Mindanao? It won't be that difficult to explain the situation.
It's going to be hard as well, Christian, but I think they'll be more understandable about this issue because the whole of EU, from London to Paris to Belgium to the Netherlands, are terrorized and intimidated by this new extremism. So they will understand that. I think they will sympathize with our plight. The only thing that we've got to be careful about is in the enforcement of peace and order. I think the PNP as well as the armed forces should really carefully monitor the administration of martial law. I have complete confidence in the capacity and ability of the martial law administrator, Secretary Lorenzana, and General
Eduardo Año.
Yeah, they're upright, straightforward, very well disciplined Filipinos, and I'm sure that they will not stand for any misuse or abuse of power under martial law.
Because, sir, others are saying that by declaring martial law to deal with the terrorism happening now in parts of Mindanao, or even rebellion as far as the government is concerned, somehow this would suggest that it would suggest victory somehow for the terrorists, because this is what they wanted in the first place. That is the opinion of a lot of observers or political analysts.
Well, that's from the communication point of view, from the messaging point of view, but as a matter of fact and law, the matter is being decided now by the Supreme Court, and I understand from your newscast this morning that oral arguments will be heard in 2-3 days' time. So I think let a third party, objective, well-trained minds decide whether there's rebellion, etc., and whether it's a fact, and whether it's lawful. I think those issues of legality and expediency is better left to the judgment of a third party rather than being argued publicly, but much less discussed while the decision is still sitting in judgment.
Now, sir, based on your conversations with members of the European Union, with certain delegates, for example, how do they see, or how concerned are they when it comes to what's happening now in Mindanao? Because they've been very active when it comes to development projects for the past several years in Mindanao, and yet this is what's happening now.
Well, Christian, when we met with the delegation, Mindanao, Marawi was not yet exploded. Marawi happened much later.
Yeah.
But I am trying to judge it from what I heard from the delegation. Number one, we have very common set of values, the Filipinos and the Europeans. Number one, in terms of legality, you know, we inherited the Anglo-American legal system.
Yes.
common law practice. But because of our Hispanic past, we have also the continental law. So our, and on top of all this legal background and legal framework, we have common Christian Judea values, you know, our religion from Spain. So they pretty well understand the value system in the Philippines and the great aspiration of Filipinos always to be free and able to speak out. So I think in that sense, we may, our European partners may see us more sympathetically and understand our situation more deeply than most.
By the way, sir, there are also concerns that the way the government has been dealing with this, understandably, this terrorism. Obviously, there's terrorism in Marawi at the very least. But there are also concerns that this approach by the government might also compromise the bigger peace process in the region, especially since, of course, others, even the, for example, the National Democratic Front of the Philippines earlier expressed concern that, of course, that the martial law declaration might also cover their own people there.
Well, this is really judgmental call, Christiane. And I think it's right for the president to say that the safety of our own people in Marawi in particular and in Mindanao in general is uppermost. And the peace talks, while it can go side by side with the fighting, he'd rather first attend to freeing our people from violence and intimidation in Mindanao. And I think that's the, I agree with that approach.
Now, sir, finally,
because you know how long have we been sitting down with the communist insurgency? We've been sitting for so long a time. How long have we been dealing to strike a peace pact with the Muslim insurgency, both MNLF, MILF, and now maybe a new set of younger leaders? I think putting the and freeing our people from Marawi is, I think, the first order of the day.
Finally, Senator, I just want to be clear. You were appointed by the President as special envoy to the EU to do what very specific job? You mentioned the troubleshooting job. What specifically? What?
Yeah. Well, we just discussed the main issues that somehow temporarily divides EU and the Philippines, which is the human rights, allegation of human rights violation, the reimposition of death penalty, and possibly the lowering of the age of liability.
So basically those issues.
Right. Those are the red issues, but associated with that is a whole flow of relations, trade, educational, cultural, that are tied to it. And if we sever that relationship with the EU, also those other relationships which are humanistic in nature would go down the line.
And by the way, earlier in his administration, the president was widely criticized because of his approach to diplomacy, to foreign relations. Do you think now, close to 1 year into office, do you think there's been some palpable improvements on the part of the president as a diplomat?
Well, I see there's a marked improvement now. Someone said, diplomacy can sometimes be very rude, and this is not only true of us, not only true of Trump, but also even during the time of Madison and Jefferson, crudeness and vulgarity was also present. So this is not an old issue. But of course, in this modern communication age, any word, a single word and a single slur will go viral and the whole world will know about it.
Thank you very much for joining us this morning. Former Senate President Edgardo Angara, who is now the Special Envoy of the Philippines to the European Union.
Salamat, Christian. Thanks.